So the focus of this paper is on some implication of global warming for the catastrophe bonds market. This with particular reference to perception and pricing on natural disasters risk. So cat bonds are natural disaster risk-linked security. They were introduced in the mid-90s after Hurricane Andrew led 11 US insurance companies to bankruptcy as a consequence of the damages inflicted by the storm. So indeed, Hurricane Andrew acted as a wake-up call for the insurance industry, showing that tail risk associated with natural disasters may be so severe that even insurance companies may not have enough resources to cover. And so the solution was seen in insurance securitization that provided an effective way of spreading natural disaster risk through financial markets and investors. So since then, the market for cat bonds has grown steadily. It's still a small market. It's currently adding to 40 US billion of standing capital. There's also evidence of changing owner composition in these assets. Currently, pension funds and mutual funds own about 30% of total assets. This differs from what we saw in the early 2000s, when most of the capital was owned by high-risk profile investors, such as hedge funds and insurance companies. And it's also important to remark the large potential of growth of this market. So the current volume of securitized capital is just about 20% of global reinsurance capital. And apparently, despite the non-brilliant performance of ILS security in 2017 and 2018 especially, there appears to be unfailing demand for these securities on the side of institutional investors. This probably has to do with the zero beta property of these assets, and so far they are not correlated with business cycle risk and therefore appear to offer interesting diversification opportunities. It's also important to remark that these developments have been coupled by a decline in risk premium as measured by the multiple, that is the average coupon to expected loss ratio that has been falling from value as high as 8 in early 2000 down to about a value of 2 in 2017 and 2018. Obviously, looking at this picture, one wonders whether the market is actually indeed correctly pricing the risk these assets are exposed to. This is particularly related to the fact that these cat bonds are largely exposed to Atlantic hurricane risk, which is a risk that climate change, global warming, may actually enhance. So it's interesting then to actually look at some evidence concerning the evolving nature of Atlantic hurricane risk. So in this picture, you see plotted what I called the loss to risk ratio for Atlantic hurricanes. This is the ratio of accurate damages over the accumulated cyclone energy index, which is a measure of Atlantic hurricane intensity. So here in the plot you see the ratio, the evolution of the ratio season by season. Clearly there is evidence of something changing in this phenomenon in terms of upward trend in the ratio as well as changing volatility. Surely season 2017 was a record season for Atlantic hurricane activities, not only for the huge damages inflicted, but also because all of the 10 season hurricanes occurred one after the other. So this is the largest number of consecutive hurricanes ever scored since the satellite era. So season 2018 was also quite noticeable. I don't have figures in the plot for that, but it's the third season in a row to show highest than average activity. And season 2019 has just started. We already waiting to know about Hurricane Dorian, now heading towards Florida after devastating Bahamas. Now, what this paper does? So, in this paper, we provide some climate econometric analysis concerning the global warming phenomenon. So, we want to assess the global warming hypothesis. Is there any global warming? That is, can we relate the warming trend in global temperature to radiative forcing, that is, to greenhouse gases emissions? And secondly, are there any feedback effects from global warming onto the natural environments in terms of higher Atlantic hurricane activities, in terms of more intense El Niño La Niña cycle? So we provide empirical evidence supporting both these views. In the light then of this finding, we then move to the financial analysis, and within a co-integration and error correction predictive regression type of modeling, we then assess the pricing of natural disaster risk in the cat bonds market. And then we conclude with some policy implications. Now, I don't have time really to go through the climate econometrics evidence in details. I would like just to show you key equations which relates the evolution of Atlantic hurricane intensity to greenhouse gases emission. There you find radiative forcing. Radiative forcing is made of different components. Greenhouse gas emission is the largest component there. And apart from the autoregressive, stationary autoregressive dynamics in this index, one can notice the contribution of greenhouse gases emission. Here is the dynamic effects entering this equation both linearly and non-linearly, as well as a contribution of global temperature volatility. So this equation is obtained out of a general to specific econometric analysis, and this is the outcome of a careful specification exercise that I don't have the time to give you details. But so when we work out the solved static long-run equation out of the dynamic model, then clearly you see here the impact of radiative forcing and global temperature volatility onto Atlantic hurricane intensity as measured by this index. This is not just evidence that holds in sample. No, we have plenty of evidence that indeed the Atlantic hurricane intensity is forecastable based on a very simple model condition to climatological information. Forecastability has to do particularly with the trend evolution of Atlantic hurricane intensity. So I would like just to draw your attention on this second plot where I'm reporting actual versus 1 year ahead forecast, out of sample forecast of Atlantic hurricane intensity. And I think the performance of this very simple model is quite extraordinary in tracking the trend evolution. Okay. So there are obviously many other factors that explain the actualization of a hurricane season, apart from what we are able to get out of the model. Now, so this has to do with then establishing evidence between a linkage between greenhouse gases emissions and Atlantic hurricane intensity. So higher greenhouse gas emission can be expected to lead to more intense Atlantic hurricane activity and therefore higher damages. So then the next issue is whether or not this evolving risk is actually priced in the cat bonds market. And this is what the financial analysis then is doing, trying to account for the downward trends in the cat bonds risk premium on the basis of financial factors and also climatological variables. As you can notice, there is evidence of a falling premium in the cat bonds market. And this is not peculiar, obviously, to the cat bonds market, because over the sample we investigate, all bonds market are showing this feature. This probably has to do with the implementation of very expansionary monetary policies to face the consequences of the two financial turmoils we have in the sample. I noticed also a change in ownership in the market, so maybe also some portfolio effects that may explain some of what we observe. And then we end up asking what is the role of the climatological variable, particularly the loss to risk ratio that seems to provide an interesting summary measure of the evolving nature of Atlantic hurricane risk. So then concerning the financial analysis, we have a very comprehensive data set, considering also corporate spread and US Treasury bill and bonds. We have the federal funds rate as our control variable for monetary policy. And in addition to the loss to risk ratio, we consider radiative forcing, so greenhouse gases emission, the ACE index and global temperature volatility. Now I have to move quick to the empirical evidence. So first of all, concerning co-integration analysis, we're able to detect two co-integrating vectors at the 10% level, driving describing the long-run evolution of four key variables in this data set, that is multiple, federal funds rate, and the triple B and double A corporate spread. When moving to the identification of the co-integrating vectors, then we find that the evidence of two reducible co-integrating vectors homogeneously relating the first one, the multiple, to the federal funds rate, and the second one relating the triple B and the double A corporate spreads. Looking at the estimated loadings, then one can conclude that the federal funds rate is the weekly exogenous variable, is one of the drivers of the trend evolution in this set of variables, and a nice error-correcting reaction of the multiple to the disequilibrium with the federal fund rate. So this is the monetary policy effect. And you can notice that also the corporate spread are reacting properly to the disequilibrium of the multiple relatively to the federal fund rate. So again, this is the monetary policy effect. And on the other end, you see that only the AA spread react to the disequilibrium with the triple B spread. This is evidence of a kind of a contagion effects, and the fact that we don't notice any reaction on the multiple to this disequilibrium is consistent with the fact that that the cat bonds are not exposed to business cycle risk. Now, let me show you the final econometric model that we get out of a careful general to specific analysis, where we consider also information from the treasury bills and bond rates, and also the double B corporate spread, and the climatological variables that I previously mentioned. So you see a very simple error correction model explaining the short-term evolution of the multiple. Here you see the contribution of the error correction term. Here you see a contribution of a variable which is reminiscent somewhat of a term spread, although the interpretation in this context cannot be the usual one, insofar as cat bonds are not responsive to business cycle risk. So we maybe probably get there some portfolio shift effect. But I would like to draw your attention on this key variable, which is the loss to risk ratio, which enters significantly the equation. But where you, but there you can see that this, the coefficient has a negative sign. So exactly the opposite that we would expect if the market was correctly pricing the risk of these assets are exposed. And this also true also when other variables are considered, other climatological variables are considered, you see here a sequence of error correction model where the climatological variables are considered one at a time, and either these variables are not entering significantly the equation, or they enter with a negative sign, so with a sign which is opposite to what we would expect if the market was actually correctly pricing the risk these assets are exposed to. So I briefly move to conclusion. So there are, I have a number of conclusions out of this study. Surely the paper deals with an important question, which has to do with accurate pricing of disaster risk in the cat bonds market. I probably failed to mention that about 50% of these assets are exposed to Atlantic hurricane risk, a risk that actually global warming and climate change may be enhancing. And it's true that the market is still small, but still has also a large potential for growth. And it's also important to notice the type of investors which are increasingly entering this market, which are fairly relative low-risk profile investors, thinking of pension funds in particular. So it's important then to assess indeed whether the market is accurately perceiving and pricing the risk. In concerning the driver of the multiple, we do find evidence of important effects coming from monetary policy, potentially also portfolio shift effects, but we do also point evidence of some mispricing in the market, insofar as we do not find evidence that climate change risk has correctly priced so far. And therefore, we call for higher awareness of cat bonds risk, particularly on the side of pension funds manager here. And possibly there might be sounder investment opportunity for institutional investors in the green bond market. It's not the case that by being green, an asset is a safe asset. It's not the case, but probably the risk to which this asset is exposing to is more understandable by investor at this stage. And there is also another important issue, because on a global scale, investment in the green bond markets may also allow for the funding of immediate investment in climate change mitigation. And meanwhile, by redirecting financial resources to the real sector and reducing the risk of the building up of financial imbalances in this way. So this is what I call a double dividend hypothesis. And I also mentioned the predictability of Atlantic hurricane intensity on the basis of greenhouse gases emission level. So I think this is an interesting result for insurance companies. And I come to my very final conclusion. This has to do with the implication for central bank regulatory supervision. This supervision is surely timely and needs intensification, and this has been so far generally concerned with the assessment of the implication of an abrupt transition to a low carbon economy. And we think that there is an additional layer of risk that has not been properly considered so far. And this risk is associated with the irreversible consequences of climate change. So the 2 Celsius degree threshold over which we may have permanent impacts on the environment. So probably this is something that has not been properly understood neither by policymaker or laymen or financial agents, something that we still fail to properly understand. And we do call for additional awareness on this feature too.